and Sherry have spent a long time, for any of you that don't know her, a very long time, a gardening specialist on the Gazette. And this is her new book today on the daily gardening, which she's going to share a lot of that information with us. So thank you, Jeff.
I can't say I'm a gardening specialist. I don't think I'm a gardening specialist. I've always said that I was a better garden writer about other people's gardens than I was myself, because I think that the most popular garden columns were when I told about my failures. And people said, oh, she has failures too. Which, of course, we all do. So, I did write a garden column for 30 years, which is a long time. And the book, Valley Gardens, is a selection of my columns from the last 10 years of my gardening column career. Because frankly, the thought of reading over 30 years of gardening columns was more than I could do, particularly since I didn't have copies, so I had to go to the libraries to read them on microfilm. And if you haven't used microfilm, it's exhausting. Particularly if you have only one eye. So I didn't want to do 30 years of it. But back in 2008, 15 years ago, my husband, who died that year, said, you must publish a collection of your garden columns. And I said, yes, dear. Then, of course, I had to deal with all what I call the legal schmeagle of when your husband dies, and getting the house ready to sell, selling the house, moving. And by the time I finished writing the garden column, the last thing I was thinking about was a book. And then in 2018, I had a heart scare. I ended up in COVID, and the doctors were trying to decide what to do. It was not, you know, a major stroke or anything. It was minor, but they wanted to prevent big problems. And so I lay there thinking, ooh, you never kept your promise, did you? And it's a long time. You better get organized. And there was nothing else to do. So I lay there in the hospital bed and plotted how I would organize a book. And then I thought, well, you stopped writing the column 3 years ago. Who's going to remember? Who's going to buy this book? And by serendipity, the male nurse who wheeled me into the procedure room said, are you the Cheryl Wilson who used to write the garden column? And I said, yes. Oh, my wife and I read that garden column every time. We loved it. We miss it. I'm so sorry that he retired. And I told him my plan, and he said, oh, we'll buy it. Don't worry. Well, at least there's one person out there who can buy it besides my friends. So I pursued doing it. And I was very pleased. The Levelist Press, which in many cases, I'm very happy to have you pay to have your book printed, said they would underwrite the cost. But they couldn't do it that year. I should come back in a year if they had a full list. Well, then COVID came, and they were closed. The libraries were closed. I couldn't get my columns. And by the time another year went by, I thought, this is ridiculous. But fortunately, some friends said, no, no, you must go back to the Levelist Press. So I did. And the head honcho said, well, he was kind of overwhelmed, but he asked his colleagues. And I thought, well, there goes that. And 2 days later, I got an email saying that Randy Sarko and Faith Seddon would shepherd my book through publication. So it was a go. And then I had to do the work. I had to how many garden columns. I had to get physical copies into my computer. And it did take a full year to do that. And finally, just about a year ago, in March, I was able to deliver the manuscript on a flash drive to Randy at the Florence branch of Leadless Press, which is also collected copies. And then I had to work on pictures. And all of these were copyright to the Gazette. So I got in touch with my friend, the photo editor, and I knew, and you know, that's in financial trouble. I thought, poor Carol, she's going to say, oh, Sherry. And instead, she said, oh, this is exciting. How many, what pictures do you need? Send me a list. And in 2 days, I had not only the pictures I asked for, but zillions of pictures that I then had to go through and find which pictures. So it's been a long process. And I would like to say that if you ever need a book designed by somebody, go to Leadless Press and ask for Faith Sim. She was just wonderful. And I've gotten so many compliments on how beautiful the book is, not just from people like you and me, but people who are book people in the business. And so I always have to say thank you to Faith. And Randy promised that the book could be out by Christmas, at least a few copies, so that I could give them to my family and friends for the holidays. And he kept his promise. And then the book launched. Thing was in February, in the middle of a snowstorm, whether you So I'd just like to say a couple more things about the book. One is, how did I choose the gardens? 10 years of garden columns. There were more than 45 of them. And there were three in Hadley, Mary Thayer and Sue Russell's gardens. We're on a tour several years ago, and I interviewed both of them, which is rare for me to do two gardens in one column. And it was such fun because they were, and so are, good friends and neighbors. Both of them, their families, date back to the 17th century or whatever. And so I learned a lot, and they're both delightful people. And then Tony Kostick was on another tour, and I found out that he did worm composting. I thought, well, that's interesting. So whenever there's a tour and the organizers want me to write a preview, they give me choices. And I chose Tony because of worm composting, and that was a real education. And
amongst all the devils in the dirt that are in this area. But anyhow, hopefully everybody's seen the table with water and various refreshments. And also, we're welcoming Sherry on behalf of the friends of the Hadley Library. So, excuse me, if anybody's interested in joining the friends or in some upcoming events, we have Luna's mini art show, and also next Wednesday, the author of a book on slavery and coming up out of slavery. I remember how to pronounce her name. Gersina, I think, is the last name. But anyhow, there are flyers there that explain all that. And Sherry has been a long time, for any of you that don't know her, a very long time gardening specialist on the Gazette. And this is her new book today on the Valley Gardens, which she's going to share a lot of that information with us. So thank you, Jeff.
I can't say I'm a garden specialist. I don't think I'm a garden specialist. I've always said that I was a better garden writer about other people's gardens than I was myself, because I think that the most popular garden columns were when I told about my failures And people said, oh, she has failures too. Of course, we all do. So I did run a garden home for 30 years, which is a long time. And the book, Valley Gardens, is a selection of my columns from the last 10 years of my gardening column career. Because frankly, the thought of reading over 30 years of gardening columns was more than I could do, particularly since I didn't have copies, so I had to go to libraries to read them on microfilm. And if you haven't used microfilm, it's exhausting. Particularly if you have only one eye. So I didn't want to do 30 years of it. But back in 2008, 15 years ago, my husband, who died that year, said, you must publish a collection of your garden columns. And I said, yes, dear. And then, of course, I had to deal with all what I call the legal schmeagle of when your husband dies, and getting the house ready to sell, selling the house, moving. And by the time I finished writing the garden column, the last thing I was thinking about was a book. And then in 2018, I had a heart scare. I ended up in COVID, and doctors were trying to decide what to do. It was not, you know, a major stroke or anything. It was minor, but they wanted to prevent big problems. And so I lay there thinking, ooh, you never kept your promise, did you? And it's a long time. You better get organized. And there was nothing else to do. So I lay here in the hospital bed and plotted how I would organize a book. And then I thought, well, you stopped writing the column 3 years ago. Who's going to remember? Who's going to buy this book? And by serendipity, the male nurse who wheeled me into the procedure room said, are you the Cheryl Wilson who used to write the garden column? And I said, yes. Oh, my wife and I read that garden column every time. We loved it, we miss it. I'm so sorry that you retired. And I told him my plan, and he said, oh, we'll buy it, don't worry. Well, at least there's one person out there who can buy it besides my friends. So I pursued doing it. And I was very pleased. The Levelist Press, which in many cases was very happy to have you pay to have your book printed, said they would underwrite the costs. But they couldn't do it that year. I should come back in a year because they had a full list. Well, then COVID came. And they were closed, the libraries were closed, I couldn't get my golf columns. And by the time another year went by, I thought this is ridiculous. But fortunately, some friends said, no, no, you must go back to the Levelist Press. So I did. And the head honcho said, well, he was kind of overwhelmed, but he asked his colleagues. And I thought, well, there goes that. And 2 days later, I got an email saying that Randy Sarko and Faith Seddon would shepherd my book through publication. So it was about. And then I had to do the work. I had to decide which garden columns, how many garden columns. I had to get physical copies into my computer. And it did take a full year to do that. And finally, just about a year ago, in March, I was able to deliver the manuscript on a flash drive to Randy at the Florence branch of Levelist Press, which is also collected copies. And then I had to work on pictures. and all of these were copyright to the Gazette. So I got in touch with my friend, the photo editor, and I knew, and you know, that's financial trouble. I thought, poor Carol, she's going to say, oh, Sherry. And instead, she said, oh, this is exciting. How many, what pictures do you need? Send me a list. And in 2 days, I had not only the pictures I asked for, but zillions of pictures that I then had to go through and find which pictures. So it's been a long process. And I would like to say that if you ever need a book designed by somebody, go to Letwood's Press and ask for Faith Sim. She was just wonderful. And I've gotten so many compliments on how beautiful the book is, not just from people like you and me, but people who are book people in the business. And so I always have to say thank you to Faith. And Randy promised that the book could be out by Christmas, at least a few copies, so that I could give them to my family and friends for the holidays. And he kept his promise. And then the book launched. The thing was in February, in the middle of a snowstorm, with a few So I'd just like to say a couple more things about the book. One is, how did I choose the gardens? 10 years of garden columns. There were more than 45 of them. And there were three in Hadley, Mary Thayer and Sue Russell's gardens were on a tour several years ago. And I interviewed both of them, which is rare for me to do two gardens in one column. And it was such fun because they were, and so are, good friends and neighbors. Both of them, their families, date back to the 17th century or whatever. And so I learned a lot. And they're both delightful people. And then Tony Kostick was on another tour. And I found out that he did worm composting. I thought, well, that's interesting. So whenever there's a tour and the organizers want me to write a preview, they give me choices. And I chose Tony because of the worm composting. And that was a real education. And in many of these gardens, I would see plants that I hadn't seen before and wanted to grow. And the one at Tony's is an enormous plant. It's called, the common name is fleece flower, and it is Persicaria polymorpha, and it really is 6 feet tall and 6 feet wide. It's a perennial. And I planted it by the front door of my condo when I moved in 8 years ago. And in the summer, and it blooms for 6 weeks or so, and anyone who comes to the door says, what's that? Because nobody's seen it. And last summer, I decided it really was a bit overwhelming. So I hired somebody to move it to the backyard in the middle of the ground. And I thought, did it die? Well, it's now about this tall. It has many too many stems. It's very happy in the backyard. And if people driving on Rambling Road will see this thing, and they may come around and say, what's that plant? And it's that kind of matter. And then the final half of the garden that's in the book is Desi and Peter Cook, who are on South Maple Street. And you all know Flavors, which is Gordon Cook and Des. And next door is his brother Peter and Betsy. Well, many, many years ago, 1988 or something, they built a house in the middle of Peter's hayfield. And if you build a house in the middle of a hayfield, it's going to get buffeted by the winds. It's going to be a real challenge. And so I was fascinated to watch over the years as they built windscreens, deciduous ones, evergreen ones. And Maple Street is one of the streets I go on a couple of times a week. So I kept tabs on this, but it didn't really dawn on me that it made a garden home until my son Sam, who's now in his 40s, said, oh, he's an artist. He said, oh, Mom, I love that. I love to watch how it's changing over the years. And I thought, well, if Sam thinks it's that good, I should write about it. So I got in touch with him and had a delightful interview and learned about haymaking. And so those are the three Hadley gardens that are in the book. There are other Hadley gardens that I've written about over the years, but they were not in that 10-year frame. And finally, people ask, how did you find the gardens in the first place? Well, when I started, it was calling up a friend and saying, could I write about your garden? Or a friend saying, I have a friend. And it kind of snowballed from there. Sometimes I would drive along a street, say, ooh, that looks interesting. Write down the address, ask around, and sure enough, there was a garden called. Friends recommended gardens. There were the tours. So there were sources beyond just me. But sometimes it was hard to find out whose garden it was. And it might take years. And I had noticed a garden in Amherst, but there was no mailbox with a number on it. And so I kind of gave up. Well, a couple of years ago, my neighbor had a huge groundhog problem. And she wanted the animal control officer to come and tell her what to do. But Sandy, my neighbor, had a doctor's appointment that morning. So she asked if I could meet with Carol Hepburn, the animal control person. I heard that Carol was a little gruff, and I said, okay. And I went over, and sure enough, Carol knew exactly what to do, got on the phone, and hired a trapper, said to me, you can go home. So I went home. And half an hour later, bang, bang, bang on the door. It was Carol. What did I do wrong? Animal control officer, not being good. And she came in and she said, you didn't tell me who you are. I said, well, who am I? She said, you write the garden column. Yes. And I wanted to ask you to come to my garden and write about it. I said, where is this garden? It was the garden that I couldn't figure out who owned it. And it is the next to the last garden in the book. Because it is a stupendous garden. And Carol made me very rough. I had to edit out some of her I remember getting in the car and saying to my son, I don't know how I'm going to write an accurate because every other word I can't use. But somehow, I managed to do it, and she's lovely article. So, but you know, all know the rhythm to gardening. In the winter, you have your catalogs, your seeds starting, and then you have your maintenance of the garden, your planting, fall planting. So there's, you know, logical way of thinking about what kind of garden you want to write about. Whether you're writing about planting broccoli in the spring or harvesting beans in the fall. So that helps. And there are events. There are so many events. And I try to be fair about the various tours that were happening. Sometimes there'd be three tours in June, and I was only supposed to write two garden columns a month. And I remember going to the then editor in charge and saying, is it okay if I write three garden columns in 1 month? Yeah, okay. That was not Jim Foody. Jim Foody would have said, sure. Anyway, over time, it was not difficult to find gardens. And garden trends have changed over the years. When I started gardening, particularly when I started with Cummel, everybody used chemical pesticides. It was just a given. In the Master Gardener training, a lot of it was how to use pesticides safely. And I remember there was a young man in my class who was organic. And he stood up and berated the extension specialist. How can you be suggesting these horrible chemicals? And the extension specialist, who didn't know any other way of gardening, says, oh, well, this is how we do it. And the young man said, I don't. And now, the Master Gardener training, there's chemicals mentioned in passing, basically, don't use them. So times have changed. And most gardeners are organic now, with a couple of exceptions about certain pests that don't like organic. Or they do like organic because then they can eat. And pollinator gardens in meadows are the latest trend. And during COVID, a lot of people, particularly young people, discovered the joy of homegrown vegetables. So times have changed, and garden design has changed. And so it was fun to record the changes over the years. So that's basically the background of the book. And I do have a bit of information about gardens to visit, but are there questions that you wanted answered?
Well, go ahead.
Did you ever go and interview someone that you then decided you couldn't use?
Well, most gardeners, as Judy knows, we talk about this ourselves, most gardeners like to talk about their gardens. And unless they're giving out bad information, it hasn't been a problem. There were, over 30 years, there were two gardeners who, when I got home, I thought, how are you going to write a garden column? The first problem person was a very young woman, probably in her 20s, who had just started gardening. And I think her mother thought I should write about her garden. And she had a beautiful annual garden. I call it beginner's luck. But she didn't know what she was doing. And so anything I asked her, I don't know. Yes. No. She was imminently unquotable. I was quite frustrated. Use a lot of background material on annuals in order to write the column. And then, a member of the garden club, whom I had known for years and years, was a typical Yankee. You don't talk unless you have to. And she grew gorgeous African violets. And so I thought, well, write about her African violets.
Well, how often do you water them?
When they need it. Do you fertilize them? Sometimes. Again, how do you quote this person? So a lot of the garden column was the history of African violets, how they came from Africa to the United States, and John Quincy Adams. And there were lovely pictures of her beautiful African violets. But it was not a monologue by any means. So that was a problem. Your other question, Cheryl.
How did you get started on the column to begin with?
Yes. Well, this is the early 1980s, and I had been a reporter, a news reporter, before we moved to Amherst, before I had children. And I went to the Amherst Bulletin and asked if I could write feature stories, because I was in no position with three small children to be a regular news reporter. And fortunately, the editor, Nick Robin, liked my work. And so I wrote a couple of feature stories a month. And then the garden writer's husband went on sabbatical to England. And she wanted to continue to write the garden column based on English gardens. Well, Nick, if you know him, is strictly a vegetable gardener, strictly an American. He advised me once that I should not be, that actually, in reverse, I shouldn't be buying American cars because they were no good. I should buy Japanese ones. But he had no interest in English gardens. And so he was grousing in the office that he didn't have anybody to write the garden column. And I said, well, I'm not a very good gardener, but I could interview people. You've got it. I said, only for a year. I'm just a substitute. Well, unfortunately for the previous garden writer, he liked my work a lot better than hers. And she came back expecting to get her garden column back. And he said, no, Cheri has the garden column. Well, this was very embarrassing because we were both members of the garden club of Amherst. And I can't blame her. It took her several years before she would even give in the light of day. We finally did end up being friends, but I could not blame her. Yeah. I had taken her column, and I said to Nick, no, I don't want to do that. It's her. He said, well, then there's no garden column. So that's how I started. And then the Gazette decided they had a garden columnist who had stopped. And they asked me if I would do the garden column in Northampton, which meant that I needed to find gardens in Northampton, which I hadn't done before. So that was a challenge. But that's how it all started.
Thank you. That's a great story.
Yes.
I was going to ask, are all of yours flower gardens that you interview for, or do you ever do vegetable gardens or container gardens?
I had a vegetable garden in Amherst. And one year we had tomato hornworm. We also had ducks. The ducks loved eating the tomato hornworms. But I was not about to let them into my garden. So I figured the kids could go into the garden and pick off these cute little bugs and throw them to the, no, mommy, I'm never going to do that. So I had to do everything. And I complained and complained. And my husband finally said to me, look, we like your vegetables, but you go to the Amherst Farmers Market every week. Why are you stressing out over growing vegetables and tomato hornworms when you're just going to go down to the market anyway? I said, okay. And that was the end of my doing vegetable gardens. And I do try on my deck of the condo to grow tomatoes in a pot, but they don't quite get enough sun. And I don't want to put them in the ground. I do have little gardens. I don't want to grow vegetables in the ground because that's 100 years ago, this was an apple orchard. And the pesticides they used were lead arsenic.
Oh, my gosh.
And although I don't have any little kids to be damaged, have their brains damaged by lead, I don't need my brain damaged. So I don't grow vegetables. I may try a pot of peppers this year. And cherry tomatoes and one regular tomato.
I've had very good cherry tomatoes on my porch with the container.
Those usually do fairly well, but keep coming. The larger ones say, you want to grow taller than your ability to stake us. So it's not very rewarding. It's more frustrating. But that's what happens at my house. But I hope you're all growing some vegetables because we need to have local vegetables instead of everything from California. Although last weekend I was in New York and my son's partner had just been in California and he brought back artichokes, which I happen to adore. Mm-hmm. And we had them for dinner last week. And they were the best artichokes I have ever eaten. And since I eat artichokes whenever I can, this is quite a compliment. So, and artichokes are rather hard to grow here. Because they don't get enough of a growing season to turn it into a California artichoke. They're pretty small. Have you done them?
No, not
artichokes. I do like them, but aren't they really hard to prepare? Mm. Get cut apart and everything. I've eaten them in restaurants, but I've never.
I would. It's like lobster. I wouldn't eat an artichoke in a restaurant because I could make a mess and be embarrassed. I cook my own lobsters and haven't had one for a while, come to think of it. I grew up in Rhode Island on a river. No lobsters in the river, but if you grew up in Rhode Island, you cook your own lobsters. Patty had asked me to speak about perhaps little known or famous Western Massachusetts gardens to visit. And Pam, I think you said you went to Lilac Land this morning.
Yes, stupendous.
I went to Lilac Land. It's in Pelham.
Yeah, the address is fresh in my mind. It's 24 Harkness Road.
Very good.
In Pelham, and maybe you're going to talk about it, but it's a private home and extensive acreage, I would say, filled with lilacs of every color and every variety, fancy ones, plain ones, and they're in full bloom now, and the lovelies are kind enough to open it up during prime season. And there's a little sign out in the front that says Lilac Land. And just go in and trip around. Of course, they ask that you be respectful of property. No cutting. There's several signs. No cutting, no picking. And keep your dog leashed. But it was just superb. I could bore you with a few pictures, too.
Yeah.
And the aroma, as soon as I opened the car door, is just intoxicating.
Oh. Yeah.
Absolutely spectacular. You must have written about them or known the ones.
No, I don't know if I ever wrote about Lilac Land. The man who started it, Al Lumley, whose son Jim has it now, Al Lumley had been, I think, the track coach at Amherst College. And when he retired, he went into real estate. And when we moved here in 1975, my husband was coming to Amherst College, and his boss got Al Lumley to drive us around and look at houses. And I can remember vividly, we had lunch at High
yellow lilacs were new. And he was so excited that he had a yellow lilac. And I just remember that. He did not sell us the house that we bought because he did not think that we could afford the house that we wanted. He thought he knew what salary my husband was going to get, which was wrong. And we wanted an old house. And he said, no, no, you need a starter house. You need a ranch house. We said, but we don't want a ranch house. So I didn't have the warm, fuzzy feelings that I should have had for outlawing because he was not on our wavelength. And I did go to Lilac Land, but I don't think I ever wrote a garden column, but I should have.
And the current Mr. Lovely, Jim Lovely, is also an artist, and he has a studio right separate from the house, you know, a little outbuilding, and the gallery was open. I assume on weekends, I don't know about during the week, but at least weekends during peak lilac time, it's open. You know, another wonderful thing to look at is his paintings besides the sizes. Twenty-four Harkness Road. If you go out Main Street in Amherst, and it becomes Pelham Road, Amherst Road, but just keep going east on Main Street, turn right on Harkness Road. So it's after Heatherstone. Harkness, it's as you're going up Pelham Hill before you get to the school on your right. Turn right and go maybe a mile, and it's on the left. And the sign says Lilac Line and Land, and there will probably be cars there, and that'll help you find it.
Amazing.
And this is the time to go. Lilacs are a May blooming flower. I can remember being puzzled when I was in sixth grade. We had to memorize poems about and there's one poem that starts out about when lilacs last in the dooryard bloomed. Well, in Rhode Island, lilacs bloomed the end of May. Lincoln died in April. And until I married a Midwesterner, I couldn't understand why this poem about Lincoln's death was all wrong. Well, in Indiana, lilacs bloom in April. And they do in Illinois, too, which is where Lincoln was from. So, yeah. But it took me until well into adulthood to understand that. There are three gardens in the book that I would recommend. One is the Orchard Arboretum at Applewood. And it's open, free to the public. It is not maintained by the Applewood Assisted Living Institution. It's maintained by the certain residents who have formed friends of the Orchard Arboretum. It's on town conservation land, so that if you donate to the Arboretum, you make out a check to the town of Amherst, which is always a little disconcerting. But it is a beautiful, small arboretum that is very well maintained. And it's right up the hill from my house, so I try to go every few days and walk around the arboretum. And the birds love it, pollinators love it. And you can park at Applewood along Spencer Drive and just walk in. And there are lots of benches, and it's a real gem that people don't really know about. And I did write about it, it was in the book. And a friend of mine, who was a professor of plant soil science at UMass a few years ago, stopped me at Big Y. He said, Sharon, did you know about the arboretum at Applewood? And I said, yes. And he said, well, I don't know why I never knew about it. I said, Bill, it's very simple. You never read my garden poem. I got a little mean, but, and he has confessed he had not read it, but he was a convert. And then the greenhouses at Mount Holyoke and Smith, and indeed the greenhouses Durfee Conservatory at UMass, are all worth a visit. It's a little hard to park at any of these, but they're worth going to. Every year, as you know, Smith has a well-publicized poem show, which is wall-to-wall people lined up. Mount Holyoke's poem show is not as well-known. It's much smaller. There's no traffic jam of people. And every year, I insisted that I write about both poem shows. And every year, my dear friend Jim Foodie would say to me in February, you are going to write about the Smith poem show. Yes, Jim. And I'm writing about the Mount Holyoke poem show. Oh, does Mount Holyoke have one? Did you ever read my garden poem? But I, fortunately, my photographer friends who were, you know, under stress even then, never objected to doing two things across the river for one garden poem. It was breaking all the rules, but they broke them with me. So, but I highly recommend both of them. And the third garden in Western Mass that's in the book is the Mount in Lenox. And this is the home, what's the home, of Edith Borden, who was a great gardener as well as a great author. And a couple of years ago, they restored the gardens. And it was at least $1 million to restore these gardens. And they are magnificent.
Golden statues.
Don't fall off your chair, let them.
Yes. My question is how long the garden was abandoned and then how they restored?
Well, they had plenty of plans and pictures, and so they were able to restore it. The central fountain, which is very dramatic, is not as tall as it used to be. But they had plenty of documentation in order to do this, and it is very much like what she had designed. And her niece, Beatrix Ferrand, designed the vegetable garden, which has not been restored. But it was, Master Gardeners took a trip there, and Judy Gottman was on the trip with us. She was a little surprised to find out that you quoted me, that I quoted you.
I had totally forgotten about that.
Sorry, I really did. I asked permission at the time, but not when I did the book. So those are the three that are in the book. Smith College has lots of gardens, and particularly the Capon Garden, which is behind buildings. So if you want to see these gardens, you should go into Lyman Plant House and ask for the map, the guide, and then you can find these various gardens. But they're beautifully maintained. In Amherst, perhaps you don't know, but the Eric Carle Museum has a meadow that was installed a few years ago in memory of Eric Carle's wife. And it doesn't look like very much right now. It won't look like very much until middle of July anyway. But then I drive past every time I leave my house and I would crane my neck to see what's in bloom because it's a very well designed and well maintained meadow. And that's hard to do. So that's July to September is the time to go see that meadow. And then the Emily Dickinson Museum has a garden that they're trying to restore, but you asked about how do they know what to restore, and that's the problem. That Emily Dickinson wrote about lots of plants, garden plants, wildflowers, house plants, but we don't know where it were in her garden or much about how they were grown. And Martin McDowell, who has written a wonderful book about her love of gardening, is trying to help restore the garden, but she's frustrated because there's no documentation, or very little documentation. And it would be lovely if somebody could find a plan, lists of plants that were bought or ordered to grow up from seed. They had vegetables. They did figure out a bit about the orchard and what apple varieties probably were planted. No proof, but what could have been planted there in 1860, say. So there are antique varieties in the apple orchard, but even that is not fully documented. And then Lilac Land, and then in Florence and Northampton, two sets of community gardens that are worth visiting just to look at them. One is longstanding Northampton Community Gardens off Route 66. And I was told years ago by the head of the Massachusetts Butterfly Association that this was prime place in Western Massachusetts, if not in the entire state, for seeing butterflies, different kinds of butterflies. And then a few years ago, they opened a new section of community gardens in the Florence section of Northampton. And there's a group called Grow Food Northampton, which does those gardens. And the Western Massachusetts Master Gardeners have a demonstration pollinator garden there. And then just up, that's on Pine Street. And just up the street is the Sojourner Truth Memorial Park. And the garden there was designed in, when the park was built, in 2004. And until 2015, the members of the board were trying to maintain it. And just before I retired, I got an email from Wendy Sinton, who was on the board, asking if the Master Gardeners would be interested in doing the maintenance. Well, I had never been to the garden or the park, but when it opened, there was a picture in the Daily Hampshire Gazette taken by my friend Cheryl Wilson. It's all her fault. She took a picture of a little toddler reaching up to touch Sojourner Truth's fingers. It's a gorgeous statue. And I took one look at that photo. I burst into tears, and I never forgot it. And so when Wendy emailed me, I didn't ask anybody. I was on the board, Western Mass, Master Gardeners, but I simply said yes. And so since 2015, a group of us have maintained that garden. This week we're going to be planting annuals and mulching. And every month we go and get ahead and weed. And there's a core group who started in 2015, and we're all good friends now who just love that garden. So, and that's on Pine Street. And how many of you have been to the Bridge of Flowers?
Bridge of Flowers?
Yes, right. That is such a wonderful. delight to be there because people from all over the world come to see it. And a couple of years ago on a weekend, this huge group of people arrived, all dressed up. And it was not a wedding, but and I always get this mixed up, whether it's when you turn 15 or 16, Latinos, people had a big celebration, and that's what it was. And the young lady was dressed in this gorgeous gown, and she had bridesmaids and brooms, and they essentially took over for quite a while. But nobody minded because it was so stunning to see the ball. So the Bridge of Flowers is a local gem. And then finally, in the Berkshires, the Berkshire Botanical Garden in West Stockbridge.
Yes, nice.
When we moved here in the 70s, we went. This isn't all that interesting. And then we went back about 10 years later, and it had improved. And now it really is a wonderful place to visit. They have a lot of demonstration gardens, particularly vegetables and fruits. And it's great for children, and beautiful perennial gardens. So that's a great place. And then Namke, particularly in peony season, which is coming up, and in Chesterwood, which was the home of Daniel Chester French, and he loved gardening and has a beautiful garden. And every summer, there is a sculpture exhibition that goes through the woods at Chesterwood, and it's a real destination. So those are the Western Mass gardens. And does anybody have any others that you would like?
There's one in West Boylston, I can't think of it.
Tower Hill.
Tower Hill, that's very nice. That's very nice.
It has been called Tower Hill Botanic Garden since it opened in the 80s. And I wrote about the opening, I remember, I was so excited. Now it is called the New England Botanic Garden at Tower Hill, which I didn't know until I was doing some research. It's a great place to go.
Why they changed the name?
And in that same area is Garden in the Woods.
I've heard that. Oh, Garden in the Woods. Garden in the Woods?
Framingham.
Yeah, that surprised me. Because it looked like a lot of it is naturalized.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I kind of, because that's the first one I visited, you know, has naturalized, so has no design at all.
Right, right. It's, it was started in the 30s by a gay couple, basically, and they wanted as natural a design as they could do. And the first time I went there was in 1986 or so. It was May, which is the best time to go. Anytime is fine, but May is the peak. And it was pouring rain. I didn't care. I loved that garden so much. But I remember it was a MasterCard bus trip, and I got home, and I was chilled to the bone. And I can remember making a mug of tea and going up, running the hot water in the bathtub, and soaking with my mug of tea for a long time. And I finally did get warm. And it was like, oh, that gorgeous garden. So it was, I did not catch cold, but I could have easily. It was quite a day. Anything else? Any questions?
Did you grow up with parents that gardened a lot, or like where did you start getting some?
Yes. My mother was a great ornamental gardener. plenty of money, which we did not have, and she ordered hybrid iris every year, and then she had to divide them and get rid of some, and she always gave some to my mother. And so I do remember they were beautiful iris, and I remember where they came from. And one thing I remember about my mother is, this is in the 40s, 50s, 60s, she gardened in a skirt. no pants. And I can remember when she visited me in Washington, D.C., and she was wearing a pants suit. My mother? In a pants suit? She gardened in a skirt. I didn't learn as much as I should have.
But for a major love it, I think I would appreciate it.
I didn't think gardening had rubbed off on my children, but it gets to be a joke on my iPhone to get pictures from New York, Connecticut, Berlin, Germany. Mom, what's this plant? This is not New England, right? but they're all doing beautiful gardens.
Yeah.
And my son, who was in Brooklyn and then was in Manhattan, for several years, every Sunday, volunteered in what is called the Green Dome, which is part of a public park in Brooklyn. And he just loved doing that. Now that he's living in Manhattan, he said, now I'm really not going to take the subway back to Brooklyn on Sunday morning to volunteer. So he's looking for some small public garden near his new apartment. I need to do some research for him.
Do you have some tips for helping us find garden helpers? I used to rely on the bulletin board at Hadley Garden and had good luck with that, and word of mouth and all that. But the good ones are full, can't take any new people. The not so good ones, I don't really need that kind of help. But we were talking earlier, especially the heavy work of edging and spreading yards and yards of mulch.
Yes.
Do you have some tips of where we can look for that kind of?
I wish that I did.
No, edging is so hard. I couldn't do it. With the poles in my leg, I couldn't do edging.
Well, that's good. See, it's a help right there.
What do you charge?
No, I said I couldn't do it. Okay. Even with the poles in my leg, I try to push it down though.
Edging is a real problem.
Edging is
hard. There are people out there, and I think word of mouth is basically how we learn about them. I know that several members of the Garden Club of Amherst have a man who comes and helps them. And I have never, well, we had somebody who mowed the lawn, and Josh did, I remember one year I had daylilies that had to be divided, and they're darn hard to divide. So Josh dug them up and did essentially the dividing, and then I potted them. But that wasn't his main thing in life. I think he enjoyed it, but that's not why he was hiring himself out. I think really word of mouth. A friend in Amherst several years ago suggested a garden column. The woman in Hadley named Fran Kakawa, who was the florist at Stop and Shop, and then she was the florist at River Valley Co-op. And Katie said, you really should write about Fran's garden. And several years ago, I realized I was going to need some help with my little pocket gardens. And so I got in touch with Fran. And for the past maybe 6 years, she's come either in the spring to clean things up and plant if I couldn't, or in the fall to plant bulbs. And this year, I said, Fran, I think you're going to have to come every month. I simply can't do it. And I have one garden that's on a slight slope, and the walker won't get there. And I'm terrified that if I go out there with my cane, I'm literally going to roll down the road. So I simply, but that's how I found her. And maybe at Wansick they have signs up. Hadley Garden Center isn't the warm, cozy place it used to be.
No, no.
Maybe at Sugarloaf in Sunderland they have recommendations.
Dan would know. Dan.
Dan's over at
Redmill? Yeah, he might know.
Yep.
A lot of things, he used to trim trees. He trimmed my trees last year, but he can't do anymore. It hurt his shoulders, so he can't have trees.
Some high schooler.
Well, I'd like someone, I mean, it'd be helpful if they know something, not just
the
right,
not just muscle.
They'll give us a plan to leave the weed. My kids.
Are you on Facebook at all?
Yeah.
Because oftentimes, like for weird things that I'm looking for, I'll just put up a thing seeking advice.
Well, I did hire someone off of Facebook,
yeah.
And it was nearly a disaster.
No, this is just to my friends. I don't put it out to the public.
Well, no, this was someone who had posted, I'm available for garden
help,
and I do this and this and this, and it
oh,
was,
dear.
It was.
Well, if you only post to your friends, though, maybe they would give you bids. I hope. What is the going rate people pay for that?
Yeah, I had hired for someone who had done work for a friend, and that was last season, was $35 an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And this year she's not taking on any new people. And I don't even know if her rate has gone up. But
that's a good rate.
Yeah, I think 35 is what people are expecting.
15 hours?
Yeah.
I'll be over.
You'd like to make the 15 hour, yeah.